Hey everybody, welcome to She Prayer Journals. And so this is my setup for the week of January 8th. And I did a book theme because I'm doing a kind of list challenge. And there's 52 prompts, and you can go to GinaDuke.com to see that on my post for last week. And I am working on getting a nice printable that you can download and keep with you in your prayer journal. But that'll be coming up shortly. I'm kind of, I have perfect clarity when it gets close to time to doing something, and then it's like I don't have enough time to do what I want to do. So I don't know why I'm wired that way, but I am. And so my list challenge, and it's called Rank and File. And my list, because I'm ranking stuff, and then I'm filing it away in my prayer journal. And so this week, it's based on books that are most life-changing. And so I will go through that with you shortly. So I've kind of got that theme going, and I even had this little sticker. Well, it's not sticker. It's scrapbook paper that said Once Upon a Time. And this stuff's old. I mean, I've just had this stuff for a long time, but it's just little stickers that I've stuck in here. This is actually a little bottle cap that's got a picture of someone holding a book, or maybe it's even a newspaper. I don't know if you can see that. But, and this looks like a book that's laid open. And so I've written on the pages. So that's the setup. Okay, so just to kind of share with you a few things that God has done. Over here in Praise and Thanksgiving, I have made my entries of things that I was thankful for that particular week. Oh my gosh, my pastor at my church, it's my home church where I grew up, where I've been visiting a lot lately, did a wonderful message about not settling. And he talked about how the two tribes of Israel, Reuben's tribe and I want to say Manasseh's tribe, which is one of Joseph's sons, where before they crossed over into the Jordan, into the promised land, and they had already conquered a lot of land and had received a lot of livestock, these two tribes said, hey, this is a great piece of land right here, good water, why don't we just stay here and y'all cross over? And Joshua was like, you're not even going to go fight with us? And so it turns out they did go fight with him, but they came back and they settled. They did not settle over in the promised land. They settled there. And so the pastor's point was that a lot of times we don't go into the promised land. We just settle where we are. We think this is just good enough. And it was a real challenge, because he went on and talked about how it was those two tribes that first fell away from the Lord, and they were the first two tribes that got pulled into captivity. And over in the New Testament, you know, even generations on down, this is where Legion, who was the demon-possessed man, where Jesus came up and freed him of the legion of demonic spirits, and he was a pig farmer, and they got into the pigs, and then the pigs went into the sea and they drowned. And so instead of people being so excited and in awe of Jesus, like, oh my gosh, this is, you know, a wonderful person, and just being awestruck, they were afraid of Jesus and they sent him away. And it's just there's people. And we're all prone to be these kind of people where it's like, we don't want to get too close to God. We don't want to be too fanatical. We don't really want to go in and do what we need to do to take the promised land. And it was just a really good message about don't settle. So let me just share that with you. Don't settle. So that blessed my heart, because it was a great, great message. I've started a new healthy regimen this year, and I'm doing really well. So I give God praise for that. And there was other things. I've got an uncle that's had some serious health issues who is making an improvement, so I made note of that. And I did not feel under freedom and forgiveness that I really struggled with anything that particular week to pray over for prayer petitions. I only had three, which is a very short list for me. And what's even more odd is they have not been answered yet. Usually I make a much longer list and I'll have a lot of answers even within a week. So this is atypical, but I've got a squiggly line down here to this little compartment that says insight and updates. What am I seeing God do with my prayer? And I'm making notes already of how that one thing, one of the prayer requests, I got an update. And I ask people for updates because I'm really, this person has asked our church to pray over something. And so the next Sunday, I went to that person and said, okay, well, give me an update because I've been praying. And that's encouraging to the body. And so that person gave me an update. And so that's where we're at. And I'll continue to pray that that comes to pass. Okay, so no answers here, no date to put in here. And in the notes section, I had, I did make note how God had answered one of my big prayers. So back here for the first week, I had listed a couple of really big, scary prayers, some big stuff. Because I just felt like maybe I'm praying too safe. My prayers are a little bit too safe. So I'm thinking, okay, we're going to ask for some seriously big stuff. Because I think God's in the mood to say yes. Well, I mean, right from the get-go, the very first one of this year, God just, I mean, he just blew me out of the water. He did something so miraculously, just so miraculous, I would have never thought that it would turn out the way that it turned out. And it just proves, he's like, it's almost like he was like, let me show off for you a little bit. That's the second time where I felt like I prayed for something and I didn't know how in the world it was going to turn out, and God just blew my socks off. And it's much too personal to share. It's not something for myself. It was something for another person. And, but oh my gosh, wonderful. But I will say there is one big prayer request that I prayed for that got a no. And the other one is not looking that good, but I'm continuing to pray because you know what? We walk by faith, not by sight. So I'm going to keep praying that. But I'm really trying to challenge myself to pray for some big stuff in 2017. And then under my heart and passion of what's going on with me, I made some personal notes. Ambassador notes. This always challenges me to make sure I'm sharing Jesus with others. I did put an entry how I share Jesus with someone. Again, that's the update to this section. And I did not feel this week that God had said anything specifically to me that I need to follow through with. And then this was just a note about another personal, big, scary, well, it's not really scary, but it's something big I'm asking for the Lord in 2017. It is something more personal for me. And I'm not sharing it because sometimes it's just too awkward for me to share some things. You know, you can't share everything. And but anyway, so this was my setup for this particular week. And I thought I would share with you the books that I have found to be the most life-changing for me. And this has got the number one spot right here. It's called Gracism, The Art of Inclusion by David A. Anderson. If you struggle with any type of racist mentality, or you want to understand better how to minister to those that are minorities, those that are marginalized, I think every church staff should read this book, and then I wish every Christian would read this book. It changed how I feel about those who live in the margins. And I went from having, I had felt convicted that I was kind of had an elitist mentality, you know, where it's always easy to tell people, you just need to get a job and let's quit giving you a bunch of free government stuff. But this book changed all that because he showed me in the scriptures how that's not the mentality that Christ Church is to have. And so basically, if I go to this page, 35, I think it is, I'll just tell you real quick, it's based upon 1 Corinthians 14, 27, where he says, now the body is not made up of one part, but of many. And so the foot can't, so if the foot should say, because I'm not a hand, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason cease to be part of the body. If the ear should say, because I'm not an eye, I do not belong to the body, it would not for that reason cease to be part of the body. If the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? And if the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? In fact, God has arranged the parts of the body, every one of them, just as he wanted them to be. If they were all one part, where would the body be? As it is, there are many parts, but one body. And so the eye can't say, to the hand, I don't need you, or to the ear, I don't need you. But he goes on, and this is really the main gist of the whole book, that it says, with the parts of the body that seem weaker, or indispensable. So when we look at people that we think are weak and indispensable, God says those are the parts and that we think are less honorable, we should treat with special honor. And the weaker one, the weaker parts, they're really indispensable. And the parts that are unpresentable, like we just think, you know, these are the people that don't need to be seen, we treat them with special modesty. That means we give them a special covering. While our presentable parts need no special treatment. You know, see, people of privilege or people who are white, we don't really need special privilege, special treatment. But God has combined the members of the body and has given honor to the parts that lacked it so that there should be no division in the body. That's how you stop division. Those of privilege treat people who are marginalized as if they are special. But that's the part that should have equal concern for each other. If one part suffers, every part suffers. If one part is honored, every part rejoices with it. Now, you are the body of Christ, and each one of you is a part of it. This is how you stop division. And so there are some sayings that he's outlined in this book, the seven sayings of a gracist. You know, that's a spin on the word racist. And special honor, lifting up the humble among us. I will lift you up. Special modesty, protecting the most vulnerable among us from embarrassment. I will cover you. No special treatment, refusing to accept special treatment if it is at the detriment of others who need it. I will share with you. Greater honor, God as a gracist has given greater honor to the humble. I will honor you. 5, no division. When the majority helps the minority and the stronger help the weaker, gracism. It keeps us from division within the body, an opposite view than normal. I will stand with you. Special or equal concern, having a heart as big for our neighbor as we do for ourselves. I will consider you and rejoices with it. When the humble or less honorable are helped, we are to rejoice with them. It's easier to weep with those who weep than to rejoice with those who rejoice, and I will celebrate with you. This was truly changed my life in so many ways. So many ways. You got to read it. I got this when I went through Trace Diaz many years ago. One of the sessions, we got this book, You Got to Keep Dancing. Tim Hansel has since went to be with the Lord, but he was seriously injured. And I think it was a mountain hiking accident where his body, his bones, he fell. And it probably should have killed him. But his bones were all shattered like a porcelain glass, but yet they were still together. So he had a lot of suffering. And so this book is about, it says here he gives a powerful account of God's working in his physical and emotional suffering, helping him discover the real meaning of joy. And there is this cool, oh, I hope I can find it. You can see I made a ton of notes in this book too. But, one of these quotes, the surest mark of a Christian is not faith or even love, but joy, Samuel Shoemaker. So if you are a person that's doing a lot of pain or suffering and you need joy to be prevalent in your life, you got to get this book. You got to keep dancing because it's some good stuff. Okay, this book, The Lord, I love the title, The Lord Told Me, I think. Oh my gosh. My boss, many years ago, early 90s, gave me this book because I felt like the Lord had spoke something specific to me. It did not come to pass. I was devastated. And he gave me this book to make sure that I was really hearing the Lord. And it has so many great tips in it as well. And it's just good stuff. Good stuff. So if you're one of those people that you're not sure you can hear the Lord, this is a good resource to read. The Best Yes by Lisa Turkhurst. I think it is great because it helps you to say no to things you don't need to be saying yes to. And I needed that in my life because I am a person that's all fired up, ready to get involved if I hear a good idea, but not everything is for me. And I have to make sure that I'm saying no to things in order to accomplish the things God has given me to do. We all need this. But as a writer, if you are a writer, I recommend you studying Lisa Turkhurst, the way she wrote in this book. It was phenomenal. Phenomenal. I like to read this book sometimes before I start writing a new chapter in a book that I'm writing on, just because it just has so many good things in it. Not that I'm copying her, but the way she words things and how she comes up with sticky statements, I feel like it just kind of helps my, it helps with my writing anointing, actually. It kind of gets the gears greased up, ready to go. Of course, I've got my book because that is extremely life-changing for me. And I hope for many of you as well, because that's the book we're using here. I haven't mentioned it yet, but that is the book we're using for this video, Organizing Your Prayer Closet. It has a 60-week structured prayer journal in it, along with prayer tips and even a tutorial on how to use the structured prayer journal. So, awesome. 2014's best book on prayer. Okay. You can get it at Amazon. You can get it off my publisher's website, Abingdon Press, anywhere. Okay, faith. Catch it. This was a book when I was getting my associates in ministry. I'm still three classes away. I'll do it sometime. But this was one of the books that I had to read for one of my classes. And I took a lot of notes, as you can tell, in this book. One thing that I walked away from was I feel like I could take the contents of this book and orchestrate a wonderful healing service for people who are sick. I really do. I don't know. I may do that sometime. I may do it. But there's also things that I've pulled out of that book that I've put on paper, and people that are truly struggling with sickness, sometimes if the Lord leads me, I will give them that piece of paper because it's got some good things about healing and building your faith. And so anyways, I loved this book. I loved it. Okay, I read this a couple of years ago on vacation. Liz Curtis Higgs, It's Good to Be Queen. It was about the Queen of Sheba, and she pulled out so many cool and awesome things out of this book, talking about the Queen of Sheba, especially in correlation or in comparison to King Solomon. Awesome. This is a great book to read. Great book to read. Okay, Possessing the Gates of the Enemy by Cindy Jacobs. All right, it's called A Training Manual for the Militant Intercession. If you are not Pentecostal or charismatic, you may not enjoy this book as much because it really is for. I'm sure she's either Pentecostal or charismatic, but there were so many things I liked in it. Some things I didn't connect with, and that's just because I haven't experienced those things, and my spirit didn't necessarily bear witness with some of the things that she talked about. But that did not mean this was not a good book. One of the things, and I was raised in a Pentecostal type or Baptist church, and one of the things that my pastor was really good to say is every supernatural thing you witness in a church service may not be God. You don't have to receive it as if everything is God. And I'm not saying that things in this book are not. I'm just saying I gleaned the things that ministered to me, and things that didn't, I just overlooked. I didn't pay any attention to it. And I've read this book over and over because I think there's so many good things in it. So if you read this book and you're like, oh my gosh, this is, because it's going to be a lot different if you come from a conservative background, take what ministers to you, and the other stuff, just don't worry about it. It wasn't anything that I thought was too way out there, but there were a couple of things that I just left alone, but there were so many good things that I did glean from it. Okay. Redeeming Love. I'm not a big fiction reader, but I read this book because it's based on Hosea and how God asked him to marry a prostitute, and the whole thing was to demonstrate how he felt when his own people, whom he loved, his bride, left him for other idols. And I'm going to tell you about this, but I'm just going to, fair warning about this book. You can see I took notes. I used post-it notes in here. About every few pages, I would have to stop and cry. Another book I did this with was Kisses from Katie. I probably should have that book in the stack, Kisses from Katie, where it talks about how she's from, I think, Brentwood, Tennessee, and 19 years old, went over to, I want to say, Uganda, and how she's, I mean, just, that's a great book to read. She has such a great gift of administration and how she deals in her mission over there. But anyways, her book and this book, I just had to stop and cry. But this book, I felt his pain, I felt her pain, and I surely felt the pain that God feels over us when we reject him and we don't act like his bride or someone who loves him, and we get caught up with our own idols and stuff. So it's an awesome book. And then, of course, Rick Warren's The Purpose-Driven Life was a great book that really helps you to focus on having a purpose-driven life and just not living here. You know, we're just not here for the ride. We have a purpose. And so those were the books that I read. Thanks for stopping by, and stick with me again. And this is my setup, and I've already started journaling. So this next week I'll talk about your favorite women in the Bible. So join me for that. In the meantime, don't forget to plan to pray, and happy prayer journaling.